Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya, Narayanam Namaskritya, Naram Chaiva Narottamam, Naram Chaiva Narottamam, Devim Saraswatim Vyasam, Devim Saraswatim Vyasam, Tato Jayamudirayet, Jayamudirayet, Ashtaprayeshu Abhadreshu, Ashtaprayeshu Abhadreshu, Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya, Bhagavati Ruttama Shloke, Bhagavati Ruttama Shloke, Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki, Krishnaya Vasudevaya, Vasudevaya, Devaki Nandanayacha, Nandanayacha, Nandagopa Kumaraya, Govindaya Namo Namaha, Namo Namaha. Kantra Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, chapter entitled Sudama Visits Lord Krishna, verse 9. Nanu Brahman Bhagavataha, and Bhagavataha, Sakha Shaksha Shriyapati, Sakha Shriyapati, Brahmanyani cha sharanyascha, sharanyascha sharanyascha, Bhagavan sattvata rishabha, sattvata rishabha, Nanu Brahman bhagavataha, Brahman bhagavataha, Sakha sakshashriyapati, sakshashriyapati, Brahmanyascha sharanyascha, sharanyascha sharanyascha, Bhagavan sattvata rishabha, sattvata rishabha, Nanu Brahmana bhagavataha, Nanu Brahmana bhagavataha, Sakha sakshachriyapati, sakshachriyapati, Brahmanyascha sharanyascha, sharanyascha, Bhagavan sattvata rishabha, sattvata rishabha, Nanu Brahmana bhagavataha, Sakha Saksha Shriyapati, Nyascha Sharanyascha, Ramanyascha Sharanyascha, Bhagavan Sattvata Rishabha, Nanu Brahmana Bhagavataha, Sakha Saksha Shriyapati, Sharanyascha, Bhagavan sattvata rishabha, Nanu Brahmana bhagavataha, Sakha Saksha Shriyapati, Brahmanyascha Sharanyascha, Bhagavan sattvata rishabha. Vaishnavis, Nanu, indeed, Brahmana, O Brahmana, Bhagavataha, of your exalted self, Sakha, the friend, Sakshat, directly, Shriyaha, of the Supreme Goddess of Fortune, Patihi, the husband, Brahmanyaha, compassionate to Brahmanas, Cha, and Sharanyaha, willing to give shelter, Cha, and Bhagavan, the Supreme Lord, Satvata, of the Yadavas, Rishabha, the best. Translation and purport by the followers of Srila Prabhupada. Sudama's wife said, "O Brahmana, isn't it true that the husband of the goddess of fortune is the personal friend of your exalted self? That greatest of Yadavas, the Supreme Lord Krishna, is compassionate to Brahmanas and very willing to grant them his shelter." Purport. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti explains in his commentary how the Brahmana's wife anticipated every possible objection her husband might make to her request that he go to Lord Krishna to beg charity. If the Brahmana might say, "How could the husband of the goddess of fortune befriend a fallen soul like myself?" She replied by saying that Lord Krishna is Brahmanya, very favorably disposed towards the Brahmanas. If Sudama might claim to have no real devotion for the Lord, she replies by saying that he is a great and wise personality who would surely obtain the shelter and mercy of the Lord. If the Brahmana might object that Lord Krishna is equally disposed to all countless unhappy conditioned souls suffering the fruits of their own karma, she replies that Lord Krishna is especially the Lord of the devotees, and thus even if he himself did not grant Sudama his mercy, certainly the devotees engaged in serving the Lord would mercifully give him some charity. Since the Lord protects the Satvatas, the members of the Yadu dynasty, what difficulty would there be for him to protect a humble Brahmana like Sudama? And what fault would be there in his doing so? Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Nama Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashyatya Desha Tarine Vancha Kalpataru Bhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhyayevacha Atitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So today morning we are discussing from the Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, one of the very sweet chapters in the later part of the 10th canto. Sanatana Goswami is in his Vaishnava Toshanitika explains that the Bhagavatam is not exactly chronological. Till the 40th chapter of the 10th canto, out of the 90 chapters, the first 40 chapters are more or less chronological, where Krishna's Vrindavan pastimes are described. Of course, he does a critical analysis and says that this pastime comes before this, this pastime comes later. But mostly, he says the Bhagavatam's first 40 chapters are chronological. And then from Dwarka, Krishna goes to Mathura, that's the next 10 chapters. And the next 5 chapters are his stay in, from Vrindavan to Mathura and then to Dwarka. So 40 chapters in Vrindavan, 10 in Mathura, and then thereafter it is Dwarka Leela. But till 55 chapter, the description is chronological. And then afterwards, it becomes more inspirational. So he differentiates between Smriti and Sphurti. Smriti is consciously cultivated remembrance, whereas Sphurti is spontaneously occurring recollection. So Smriti is what we as sadhakas need to cultivate. And that was what Sukadeva Goswami was also doing. But as he describes more and more the pastimes of Krishna, he goes into ecstasy. And as he goes deeper and deeper into ecstasy, he leaves linear chronology behind. And as his thoughts go in various directions, he describes the pastimes accordingly. So for example, after describing Rukmini's marriage, immediately instead of describing Krishna's marriage with other queens, the Sukadeva Goswami describes about the sons of Rukmini, and like that it goes on. So now, here, if we see some of the chapters, this particular chapter of the Sudama Brahman, this, has it really happened exactly after the Kurukshetra war or before the Kurukshetra war? It's not going linearly over here. But essentially, the Bhagavatam is describing the bhaktavatsalya, the very intimate affection the Lord has for His devotees. And the previous verses have described how Sudama was in such great poverty that he was trembling, and his wife was also emaciated and weak, and she was also trembling in fear. So it's significant that even 5,000 years ago, before Kali Yuga had started, before all the degradation of this age had come in, even at that time, there could be a situation where a Brahmana did not get enough charity, even for survival. Sometimes we tend to have a very, very monochrome vision of the past. Monochrome vision means we think that everyone in the past was a devotee. Actually, everyone was Krishna conscious in the past. But actually, this is an impersonalist vision of history. Not that we are saying there is impersonalism, but throughout history, there are different kinds of people with different orientations, and they have always lived. And Krishna himself is talking about his times. When he says in 4.3 in the Bhagavad Gita that Sakalene hamahata yogo nashtaha parantapa. So he's saying that by the power of time, that original knowledge of dharma which I have taught, which I had taught long ago to the sun god, he has mentioned that in 4.1. Now he's saying that is lost. 4.2 and 4.3, 4.2 he says this. And 4.3 says, now I'll give this knowledge to you. That means the culture that is depicted in the Mahabharata or in the Bhagavatam at the time of Krishna is not necessarily the ideal culture. Krishna is saying, Sakalene hamahata yogo nashta. By the power of time, it has declined. And therefore, for example, we have, even at those times, there are sages who are impersonalists. There are sages who are of the proponents of the six systems of philosophy. There are even skeptics and atheists at all times. In fact, you know, among all the classical languages, like Greek, Latin, Sanskrit, if we see, the maximum number of atheistic books have been written in Sanskrit. How is that? Because Buddhism and Jainism at one time were very intellectually dominant. And from the 5th century BC to 5th century AD, India was practically ruled by Buddhism and Jainism. And they wrote books in Sanskrit debunking the existence of God. So they were ideologically very different, but culturally they were quite similar. Still, the point is that even at the time of Krishna, there could be a situation where a Brahmana was not giving charity. That means even at Krishna's times, there was not necessarily a uniform Brahminical culture at all places. So we see that there is variety even at those times. Sometimes we say that this modern urban culture is bad and the rural culture, traditional eco-friendly living is good. Yes, that is true. At the same time, the rural-urban division was there even in the past. Vrindavan was an urban, so rural place. Mathura was an urban place. So the Bhagavatam describes cities. So the principle is that there is variety everywhere in this world. And we have to see which aspects of those variety are favorable for bhakti and which are unfavorable for bhakti. So anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam. Now among the six elements of Sharanagati that are described by the Goswamis, the first two, the last four are emotions or dispositions. You know, have faith that Krishna will protect, have the faith that Krishna is your maintainer, feel worthless without Krishna, offer oneself to Krishna, everything. Goptve varanapata atmanikshepa karpani charvidha charanagati. But the first, last four are dispositions which take time to cultivate. But the first two are actions. Anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam. Accept that which is favorable and reject that which is unfavorable. And this is the dynamic element of surrender. Now, we know that the quintessential example of surrender is Draupadi raising her hands up and saying, Krishna, save me. Yes, that is surrender. And we see in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna calls upon Arjuna to surrender. Sarvadharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja. Surrender to me. And Arjuna says in 18.73, yes, I do surrender. Karishye vachanam tava. But after surrendering, how does Arjuna surrender? It is not by raising his hands in helplessness. Arjuna raises his bow in readiness to fight. So surrender can have different modes in different situations. What is anukul for us to go towards Krishna, that we accept. What is pratikul, we reject. So surrender is not necessary, not at all passivity. It is actually active. But what kind of action will lead us to closer to Krishna? For that, we need to use our intelligence guided by Guru Sadhu Shastra. So in this particular pastime, there are many lessons which are being taught. One, of course, is how Krishna is so wonderfully bhaktvatsala. Another lesson is that at a subtler level, we should not be attached to being detached. We should not be attached to being detached. Normally, we think of relationships and things in this world in two terms. There's attachment and there is detachment. Yes, both these are valid, but beyond attachment and detachment, there is commitment. And bhakti is primarily about commitment. Bhakti is not about attachment, bhakti is not about detachment, it is about commitment. In the first six chapters of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna repeatedly talks about being detached, being equipoised, staying sukhe dukhe samay krutva labha labhau jaya jayo. Be equipoised among all ups and downs. But from 7.1 onwards, the mood and the focus of the Bhagavad Gita changes. That is, the bhakti section starts in the Bhagavad Gita. And the very first verse of the seventh chapter is Mai Asakta Manaha. So Krishna shifts his focus from detachment from the world to attachment to him. So now, in this particular pastime, or at this particular juncture, Sudama's wife has approached him and is requesting him that, please, we don't have even the basic necessities of life. You have a Krishna as your close friend. Please go and approach him and ask him for some charity. And whatever objection Sudama might have, his wife is anticipating and addressing those objections here. And in this way, she is urging him to go to Krishna. So, here we will see how Sudama reluctantly goes, and eventually when he goes and meets Krishna, he doesn't go actually to ask Krishna for help. He goes to Krishna just to have darshan of Krishna, and Krishna profusely satisfies without even mentioning that I'll be satisfying. So, this is an example of a transcendental give and take, where the person who needs, that doesn't ask, and the person who gives doesn't tell that I am giving this to you. So there is such a mutual understanding between the two that the needs are understood and the needs are provided for without even being asked. So this is actually a very close relationship. Sometimes when two people are very close to each other, just glance at each other, and just by glancing, you know, the other person understands this is what they want me to do, and then they do it. So this requires a very close connection, and that sort of proximity is demonstrated later in this pastime, wherein Krishna, Sudama does not ask and Krishna provides without Sudama's asking. Now, regarding the specific point of not be attached to being detached, it is described that Sudama, he was living simply and he had some sense of attachment to his renunciation, to his detachment. And he felt, oh yes, I am such an austere Brahmana, I am living so simply. And Krishna, by giving him opulence, freed him from that attachment to detachment. Of course, for most of us, it is we have actually attachment that is a problem. For most of us, that kind of attachment we don't have as a problem. And we do need to hear about detachment, because the Bhagavatam consistently talks about detachment, so that we can not get entangled in this world. At the same time, the teaching of detachment in a culture of non-commitment can breed irresponsibility. The Bhagavatam is spoken in a culture where people were responsible in their relationships. Now, the family was an integrated unit, and within that family, the family attachments could stop a person from growing onward towards Krishna. In such a situation, to ensure that the person's consciousness keeps expanding, the talk of detachment is important. But in today's culture, where there is very little commitment in relationships, where people don't even form relationships in terms of taking any... Many countries nowadays, you know, if you meet a man or a woman, you don't ask, are you married or who is your husband or your wife. You know, it's just, they say, he's my partner. So, or the other more politically correct word is, your significant other. significant other they use, because the partner may not even be of the opposite sex. The partner may be of the same gender also. So the point here is that that actually today there is very little, in many countries the commitment in relationships is not there. We are increasingly becoming a commitment averse culture, and in a culture where people are averse to commitments, then if someone hears about detachment, then that detachment becomes a rationalization for one's own irresponsibility. So the way it is, see, normally we all tend to be self-centered and selfish. And when we form relationships, those relationships get us out of our self-centeredness. Now every relationship is an attack on the self-centered ego. Any relationship that we form, if I am just alone and I am self-centered, I will do whatever I want, whenever I want, however I want. But if I have a relationship with someone, then in that relationship, I have to do the things which they want me to do. I have certain obligations in those relationships, and they force me to think of something other than myself. And in that way, every relationship helps our consciousness to grow outside of ourselves. Now, it may well be that we may have relationships with those who are materialistic, who are non-devotional or even anti-devotional. And in trying to pander to them, our consciousness may get degraded. We may be forced to do things which are unfavorable for our principles. And this is what happened to Karna. Karna was relatively speaking a virtuous person, but by his attachment to Duryodhana, he not only became vicious, but at particular points in the Mahabharata, he acted more viciously than Duryodhana also. And it was he who suggested that Draupadi be disrobed. It was he who called Draupadi a prostitute. These are horrendous accusations and horrendous ideas to actually come up with. And late, to his credit, Karna regrets this later. Twice, when he's meeting with Krishna and later when he's meeting with Bhishma, he says it was because of the desire to please Duryodhana that I spoke and did those things. So the point is that sometimes our relationships can bring out the worst within us, especially if those whom we are attached to are of a lower moral level than us, and they want us to do things at their level, then the relationships can bring the lower side out of us. But still, the point is, our relationships get us out of ourselves. And when we live in a commitment-averse culture and people don't form relationships, then the self becomes like a black hole into which people sink into themselves. Now, people I'm like this, I'm like that. Whether it's positive or negative, people become not just self-centered, but self-obsessed. And deeper and deeper one sinks into oneself. So many of the mental problems that people face today, of course, mental problems is a complex subject, and sometimes they may have some problems with brain structure imbalance or brain chemical imbalance. But to a large extent, many of the mental problems that we face are because we are living too much inside our head. We are living too much inside ourselves, and a sense of commitment, living for something bigger than ourselves, that can help us get out of our head and get into the world. Now, relationships in that sense are actually, we are social creatures and we need relationships. Now, there are two extremes when we look at our worldly relationships. Worldly relationships in terms of our family, our friends, especially the family relationships. One extreme is to think that they are all mundane and we should just reject them. I'll come to that a little later. But the other extreme is to think that they are itself my duty, and these itself are spiritual, and there's nothing more that I need to do in any of my relationships. All I need to do is just take care of my family, take care of this, take care of my children, take care of these things, and that's all. If I've done that, I'm already a very dharmic, saintly person. So actually there is adharma, there is aparadharma, and there is paradharma. Now, when Krishna says, sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam raja, give up all varieties of religion and surrender unto me. There is a Hindu commentator on the Gita, he says that, you know, this doesn't make any sense. Krishna has come to establish dharma. Dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. In 4.8 he has said. So why would Krishna now say sarva dharma and parityajya? So he says actually there is a recension error in the Gita. Recension means as over the generations the book has been written down again and again. There's an error and he says actually the verse is sarva adharma and parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraja. So Krishna is saying give up all adharma and surrender unto me. So actually, the level of the Gita at that level is very high. And when Krishna says, sarva dharman parityajya, what does he mean by that? Why is he saying sarva dharman parityajya? The Prabhupada says in a lecture that the hippies had also done sarva dharman parityajya. You know, they had given up their duty to their family, to their education, to their career, they had given up their job, they had given up their duty to their nation. But that had only taken them down to tamoguna. The important thing is mam ekam sharanam vraja. Surrender to me. That is what is important. Now, to understand this point of sarvadharman parityajya, we actually need to look at the Mahabharata. In the Bhagavad Gita comes in the Bhishma Parva of the Mahabharata. The Parva before that is the Udyoga Parva. The Udyog Parva has two main activities. One is that the Pandavas are hoping for the best and preparing for the worst. Hoping for the best, that is the normal strategy of any army. For a war, they hope for the best, that there will be no war, there will be peaceful cessation of hostilities. So the Pandavas are trying for peace by various means. At the same time, they are also preparing for war by making allies. So at that time also there is a similar discussion between Krishna and Yudhishthir. And basically, the Dharma Sankat that the Pandavas face consistently, and even Arjuna also had the Dharma Sankat, he has his Kshatriya Dharma and he has his Kula Dharma. The Kshatriya Dharma is that as a Kshatriya, if anybody is aggressor, he has to counter them. The Kula Dharma is that he, as a member of a particular dynasty, he should protect the members of that dynasty. So now, which Dharma should he follow? If he follows Kshatriya Dharma, he has to fight against the Kauravas. If he follows his Kula Dharma, he should not fight against them. And that's why the Bhagavad Gita is not a simple question of conversation or a simple question about whether I should fight or not. Arjuna, when he surrenders to Krishna, does not ask Krishna, should I fight? He says, Pruchhami Tvam Dharma Sammoodha Chetaha. I ask you, what is Dharma? The Bhagavad Gita is not simply a book about, say, one warrior who lost his nerve before a war and another warrior told him to fight. It would not have had timeless relevance. The Bhagavad Gita is not a book of violence. The Bhagavad Gita is not a book of silence. The Bhagavad Gita is a book of transcendence. Not violence, not silence, but transcendence. And Krishna, when he answers Arjuna's question, sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam, just surrender to me. That means, what is he saying here? If we see after that, what does Arjuna do? Arjuna lifts up his bow and fights. So basically when Krishna says sarva dharman parityajya, he is not implying that give up all dharma literally and become adharmic. He is saying focus on mam ekam sharanam vraja, focus on surrendering to me, and for surrendering to me, whichever dharma is anukul, you accept that. So in the case of the practice, in Arjuna's situation, the kshatriya dharma was anukul for mam ekam sharanam vraja, and the kula dharma was pratikul for mam ekam sharanam vraja. And that's why Arjuna accepted the kshatriya dharma and fought the war. And he subordinated the kula dharma, which would have required him to protect his relatives. So essentially, even when we talk about paradharma, Krishna is telling Arjuna to accept paradharma. But paradharma cannot be practiced merely by the rejection of aparadharma or adharma. Adharma of course has to be rejected. But as long as we are in this world, we have to function in this world. And we need some structure, we need some relationship, we need some role in this world. And whatever roles and responsibilities are favorable for our acting in this world, that is what we need to accept. So in Arjuna's situation, his role as a Kshatriya was anukul for his charan, and he accepted that. So coming back to our point about relationships, that essentially we want to develop our relationship with Krishna, which is, we can say, our vertical relationship. And we have our horizontal relationship with others. So now these are two dharmas. We have the paradharma of bhakti, and we have the family dharma, we may have, which is with other members in society, other members in our family. So in this situation, these two relationships, the ideal is when they are symbiotic. Symbiotic means that actually our relationship with Krishna gives us inner satisfaction. And with that inner satisfaction, with that inner strength that we get, we can act more maturely, being more understanding and more tolerant, more sensitive in our horizontal relationships. The primary difference between attachment and commitment is in terms of emotional dependence. Now, when we are attached to someone, we are emotionally dependent on that person. And because of that emotional dependence on that person, we just can't tolerate the idea that that person may be displeased with me, and therefore we do whatever it takes to please that person. And that's what happened to Dhritarashtra in his relationship with Duryodhana. Duryodhana, he basically knew which buttons to press so that he could just make Dhritarashtra dance according to his tunes. And Dhritarashtra's, you know, whatever he was not able to achieve because of his being visually impaired, whatever he's not able to achieve, he wanted to vicariously achieve that through Duryodhana. And for that purpose, he just couldn't tolerate the idea of displeasing Duryodhana. And that's why Duryodhana was able to manipulate him. So when our basic sense of self-identity, our self-worth comes from someone else in a relationship, then we become emotionally dependent on them. That itself means that we are emotionally dependent on them. And when we are emotionally dependent on them, then they can manipulate us. They can control us. They can make us do things which are not good for us, which are against our principles, which harm us and which may even harm them later. That's what happened. Dhritarashtra's consenting to Duryodhana's atrocities eventually caused the destruction of Duryodhana himself. So now the difference between attachment and commitment, as I said, is in terms of emotional dependence and lack of emotional dependence. So commitment essentially conveys the idea of conscious choosing. Yes, this is a relationship I want to develop, and therefore I will act in a particular way in this relationship. So commitment involves conscious choosing, whereas attachment is focused on emotional neediness. I can't be without this person. You know, I need them, and therefore I'll do whatever it takes. So when there is commitment in the relationship, we will go, if it's required in a particular relationship, we will go out of our comfort zone. We may do things which we would normally not do to please the other person. But that is a conscious choice. When we understand that, okay, this is what they need and this is what I would like to do. But in every relationship, there has to be give and take. Sometimes we do something for others, sometimes others do something for us. So when there is commitment, then we may go out of our comfort zone and do things for others which we would normally not do. But that is as a conscious choice. That is not because of emotional neediness. And that's why we have a sense of control. Okay, this far I can go, this beyond this I cannot go. And that way we can choose. So now, as I was saying, that the vertical relationship and the horizontal relationship, the ideal situation is where they are symbiotic. So when we get our nourishment from our relationship with Krishna, when we practice bhakti strongly, we are enriched within by our bhakti practice, then our emotional neediness is fulfilled by Krishna. And then in whatever relationship we have with others, we are not emotionally dependent on them. Even on devotees, we should be spiritually dependent. But when we are emotionally dependent on devotees, that means we just feel, oh, I have to be with them, and you know, they have to spend time with me. And then we become very, very demanding from devotees. And we will find that when devotees are not able to give us that much time, as much as we want, then we will say, devotees don't care for me. Nobody cares for me. Nobody likes me. Nobody appreciates me. It's not like that. It is not that people don't appreciate us, but everybody has limited time. Everybody is a finite human being. And if they be very advanced devotees, but they also have 24 hours in a day. And they care for us, but when we are emotionally dependent, we expect too much from others, and that causes frustration. So when we practice bhakti seriously, we get fulfilled in our relationship with Krishna. That does not mean we don't need other relationships. We almost need other relationships. But we are not emotionally dependent in those relationships. Then we can act maturely in a reciprocal way in those relationships. Now, interestingly, sometimes we try to separate our relationship into material and spiritual. You know, okay, this is a material relationship, this is a spiritual relationship. Now, this can sometimes be unhealthy. Because ultimately, you know, we are conscious beings. And the material spiritual separation is good so that we make sure that we give due time for spiritual activities. That if I start thinking everything that I do is spiritual, then what happens is nothing I do will be spiritual. If I start claiming that, oh, my job is spiritual, my home is spiritual. Nowadays, there's a whole trend. People say, my office is spiritual. Now, the word spiritual is used by people to say, to refer to whatever makes them feel good. So they say, my office is a very spiritual place. Now, why? Why is office spiritual? Because their home is like Kurukshetra for them. There are so many conflicts, misunderstandings, cold wars going on at home that people feel, I go to office, things are much better. Everything is organized. I perform, I get results, I get accolades. So, just there, the evasion of a problematic situation is not spiritual. It can be, but it is not necessarily that we can simplistically call some things which just feel good as spiritual. So, the ideal situation, as I said, is when our vertical relationship nourishes us and then we act maturely in our horizontal relationships. Now, in our horizontal relationship also, we have a relationship with devotees. And we get caring, we get nourishment, we get inspiration in those relationships. And they also inspire us in our vertical relationship. So, when we associate with devotees who inspire us, that inspires us to practice bhakti more seriously. Now, association of devotees essentially means transfer of desires. You know, the essence of devotee association is the transfer of desires. If we associate with some devotees, we hear their classes or whatever, what should happen? The devotees are energized with the desire to serve Krishna. And that energy of the desire to serve Krishna should come to us. You know, after Krishna spoke the Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna, Arjuna did not say, wonderful lecture. What did Arjuna say? Karishye vachinam tava. I will do your will. So essentially what happened was, there was a transfer of desire. So the essence of a devotee association is transfer of desire. The devotees have a great desire to serve Krishna and we get a similar desire by that association. So I was talking about horizontal relationships. Sometimes we may separate those horizontal relationships into material and spiritual. Now, for analytical purposes, in terms of giving due time to our spiritual activities, this is good. We should separate. Okay, this is material, this is spiritual. So that we ensure, as I said, that we give enough time to the spiritual. But once we have done that, we have time for our sadhana, we have time for satsang, then on a day-to-day basis when we are acting, we shouldn't always be analyzing, this is material, this is spiritual. No, the focus should be on how I can serve. Every relationship is an opportunity for serving. How can I serve in this relationship? That has to be the focus. Because if we get too much into the material-spiritual division, we can become very insensitive. And the point is, we are servants and we serve Krishna directly by practicing bhakti. We serve Krishna directly by serving devotees. But even in our family, you know, the material-spiritual is actually a very subtle division. There, if our family members are not devotees, their relationship with us may be material, but our relationship with them may be spiritual. That their relationship with us may be material because they just see us as my son, my husband, my wife or whatever. But our relationship with them can be spiritual. And this is pointed to in the second canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam when Duryodhana speaks very harsh words to Vidura. And Vidura, feeling very pained by those harsh words, he leaves the palace. He keeps his bow at the door and just leaves the palace. Now it is interesting, the Bhagavatam says at this point that Vidura saw the actions of the Lord. Vidura saw the hand of the Lord in this, that Krishna arranged for him to become disentangled for this. he saw the hand of Krishna in the harsh interaction which Duryodhana had with him. Now, Duryodhana was not acting according to any divine arrangement, in the sense that he was not a surrendered devotee who was acting to according to Krishna's will. So Duryodhana was acting under Mahamaya. But within that action of Mahamaya, Vidura saw the action of Yogamaya. This is an arrangement by which I can go closer to Krishna. That means Duryodhana was acting in that relationship in a material way. But Vidura saw that in a spiritual way. The acharyas explain that the major Vidura and Vibhishan were in similar situations. But they chose different courses of action. Vibhishan went over to the side of Ram, whereas Vidura did not go over to the side of Krishna. Why is that? That's because Vidura was, because the main villain in the Ramayana was incorrigible. That was Ravana. There was no chance of he being reformed. Now, on the other hand, Vidura's really close relationship was with Dhritarashtra, and Dhritarashtra was not innately evil. He was circumstantially acting in evil ways. And if Vidura had gone over to the Pandava side, and Vidura had been a party of those who killed Dhritarashtra's sons, then Dhritarashtra would have become closed to Vidura. You were a part of those who killed my sons. Because Vidura was not a part of that whole thing, so when later Vidura came back, Dhritarashtra could hear from him. And Dhritarashtra heard from him and became detached. And he was also able to attain life's perfection later. So the point is, Dhritarashtra was acting in a material way in the relationship with Vidura. But Vidura acted in a spiritual way. And the essence of acting in a spiritual way is, how can I best serve? How can I serve in this relationship? So serve means we serve that person and we serve Krishna by our actions in that relationship. So I'll conclude with one example of how our relationship with Krishna can inspire us to in our horizontal relationships also. Sometimes, say, if there's a cloth shop in which there's an attendant who is showing the clothes and there is a boss, there is a supervisor or the owner who is sitting at the cash counter and is observing all the attendants. So at that time, some customers are very, very picky. Now some customers may come and they may see 100 clothes and they may not choose even one cloth. Now they may open all the clothes, unwind them, and it's very irritating for the attendant. You wasted so much of my time. Now, if the attendant gets angry by that, the attendant may say, you know, I did not make any sale. I lost so much time. The attendant may get angry. But if the attendant remembers that actually my salary is coming from my boss, and my boss is observing not just whether I make a sale or not, my boss also observes how I behave. Some customers who are troublesome, you know, the boss also knows they're troublesome. And then if my boss sees that I'm still patient, I'm still courteous, I'm still cool, even amidst such provoking people, and the boss will observe that, appreciate that, you're a cool-headed person. So the person may not make a sale over there, but the person may win the appreciation of the boss by proper conduct. That's why in our relationship with anyone, there is always, it's not never just a relationship between one and the other. It is, I was in Melbourne recently, so one devotee asked this question. Then a chit, they said that, one devotee has told me that they don't like me. And if, what should I do in such a relationship? And they said that, and if they are present here, what would you like to tell them? So I gave the same example and I told them that, as devotees, we have a relationship with others, but our relationship is not only with them. Every relationship is also a relationship with Krishna. And how we act in that relationship, even if that is not a devotional relationship, how we act in that relationship can enable us to go closer to Krishna. Okay. And that's why, seems simply, this is material, this is spiritual, this is a little rudimentary way of looking. The Madhyama Adhikari, the Kanishtha Adhikari thinks Krishna is present as a deity and nowhere else Krishna is there. That means wherever there is externally spiritual, that is spiritual. Wherever there is externally nothing spiritual, that is material. But the Madhyama sees gradations. Ishwarishetadani. He says, Balisheshu Dishatsu. He says that Ishwarishetadani Adhineshu Balisheshu Dishatsu Cha prema maitri krupa peksha yah karoti sa madhyama. So basically that madhyama sees that yes, I have to devote myself to Krishna, I have to befriend the devotees, I have to show compassion to the innocent, and I have to stay away from the envious. What this means is this is not simply like a code of conduct. This is how you should behave. That code of conduct is there, but more importantly, it stems from an expanded awareness of how our relationship with Krishna develops. My relationship with Krishna doesn't just develop by how nicely I bow down before the deities. It also develops by how well I conduct myself with devotees. It also develops by how I deal with non-devotees. If some non-devotees, if we meet non-devotees, and if the non-devotees just by an interaction with us feel, I met a nice person. These Hare Krishna people are nice. And that is beginning, that is giving them Agyan Sukriti. And by helping them develop their relationship with Krishna, we are developing our relationship with Krishna. So that's why every relationship, if we primarily make the commitment to relate with Krishna, then the other relationships are seen as ways for developing that relationship. Some relationships may be very unfavorable and we may have to keep a distance in them. But essentially, rather than seeing relationships as material or spiritual, we focus on how can I serve? How can I serve Krishna through this relationship? And that mood can help us to spiritualize all relationships. Even those relationships which are difficult or are hostile for our bhakti, even them we can act in a more spiritual way by seeing that this is also an opportunity in which I can serve. How we serve, that will vary from time, place to circumstance. The dami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayanti te. Krishna says, those who serve him sincerely, he will give them the intelligence of how to practice bhakti. So here we'll see that Sudama actually goes to Krishna at the bidding of his wife. And when he goes to her, he has a spiritually nourishing interaction with him. And his material needs are also taken care of. He's already a great devotee, but this whole pastime of Sudama going to Krishna and Krishna revealing his love, all that happens because Sudama's wife impels him to go to Krishna. Now, was her motivation material? Was it spiritual? We see that she was concerned about maintaining her family, but she was also thinking about it in a spiritual way. Saying that Krishna is bhaktavatsala, Krishna is brahmanya, is brahmanyascha sharanyascha. So there is no need to rigidly differentiate between material and spiritual. Focus on what is anukul to our bhakti, what is best for our service to Krishna, and based on that, we act in our various relationships. Krishna, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Krishna das ei vishwas korle tovara dukkha nahi. If we just become convinced that I am meant to serve Krishna, whatever situation I am in, whatever relationship I am in, whatever position I am in, I am meant to serve Krishna. With that conviction, if we move, then we can steadily move onwards through whatever life sends our way. I'll summarize. I started by talking about how in this section we see that even in Krishna's time, there could be Brahmanas who were poverty stricken. So it was not that everything was hunky-dory in the past. There was ups and there were dualities, and there were places where dharma was not so prominent even in the past. And this specific pastime, we discussed about the topic was don't be attached to being detached. So we discussed about attachment, detachment, and beyond that is commitment. So normally, every relationship helps us to bring us out of ourselves. Otherwise, the self is like a black hole into which we may sink. Now, if the relationships are with people who are non-devotional, anti-devotional, that may drag us down. That may bring the worst out of us, as happened with Karna. But essentially, relationships bring us out of ourselves. And when we act in a relation, when we act in bhakti, the primary focus is not on detachment, but it is on attachment. Mai asakta manaha. We discussed that we relate with Krishna directly in our vertical relationship, but our relationship with Krishna also depends on how we relate with others. And if we are emotionally dependent, then we are attached. And then that makes us manipulable by others, as Dhritarashtra was manipulated by Duryodhana. And how do we avoid that emotional dependence? That is by focusing on our vertical relationship and getting inner nourishment, inner satisfaction by serious practice of bhakti. Then, once our emotional need is primarily fulfilled therein, then we can act appropriately in our horizontal relationships. In our horizontal relationships, I said that in terms of, we shouldn't just rigidly separate as material and spiritual. Yes, we need to divide our time, life into material and spiritual so that we get adequate time for the spiritual, directly spiritual activities. But beyond that, our process, the process of bhakti is to spiritualize even the material. So others may be relating with us in a material relationship, but we can relate with them spiritually. Dhritarashtra and Duryodhana saw Vidura materially, but Vidura related with them in a spiritual way. And the way, the strong, better we are in our horizontal relationship, sorry, in the vertical relationship, the better we can act, more maturely we can act in our horizontal relationships. Give the example of how attendant in a cloth shop doesn't just see how the customer is behaving. This is how I can best please my supervisor. So Krishna is our supervisor who is present in our heart. And by acting with the intention of serving him, we can consistently find the best way to act without insensitivity, without irresponsibility, that we don't have to give up our material dharmas, but rather we spiritualize them according to what is favorable for our bhakti. So that understanding that favorable, what is favorable, that is the dynamic aspect of surrender. And that dynamism, if it animates our bhakti, then wherever we are, we can find out how to best serve Krishna and keep marching ahead. Thank you very much. Any comments, corrections, questions?
Thank you, Prabhuji, for yet another power-packed class. My question is as follows. I was once giving a similar guidance to one of the devotees, and then immediate question he asked was that when I am talking in connection with the horizontal relationship, and the point which you made was that how even our horizontal relationships can actually strengthen our relationship with Krishna, that cloth merchant example which you gave. So in this connection, this devotee asked me that, okay, so when I am serving, let's say, my mother, you know, then I am serving with an ulterior motive of actually serving Krishna, you know. So then, am I really serving mother or am I serving Krishna? So then the reply which I gave was that that's the beauty of Krishna consciousness, that serving Krishna does not come at the cost of serving anybody else, because Krishna is, everything is included within Krishna consciousness. Then the offshoot of this, the natural consequence of this could be that madha seva, mana seva, you know. So how do we reconcile these three points?
Okay. So the question is, say if I serve my mother because I am a devotee of Krishna, then am I serving my mother or am I serving Krishna actually? See, we shouldn't be in a hyper-analytical mood. For example, right, we hear a joke in a class. Then am I laughing for my sense gratification or am I laughing for Krishna's pleasure? You know? So basically, act in the best way in which we can serve. And the important point is that we do the right thing and gradually the right motivation will come. So what is the right motivation? Prabhupada said that Krishna wrote my books. I did not write my books, Krishna wrote the books. Now Krishna wrote Prabhupada's books. Does that mean that Prabhupada did not write the books? Then Prabhupada could just have put Krishna's name as the author of the books. If Krishna has written the books, why has Prabhupada put his name? So Krishna wrote the books through Prabhupada. So Prabhupada's individuality, the Acharya's books are written by Krishna, but still Prabhupada's individuality that comes in his books, Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur's individuality comes in his books, and Bhaktivinoda Thakur's individuality comes in his books. So the point is that we all, rather than fragmenting, prithaktvena tu jnanam nana bhavan prithakvidan, vetti sarveshu bhuteshu tad jnanam vidhi rajasam, trying to separate everything into too many analytical categories, that is actually in the mode of passion, knowledge in the mode of passion. So primarily we are meant to serve, and sometimes we may feel that, oh, my mother has done so much for me, and we feel inspired to serve our mother, and that time our focus will be on serving her, thinking how much she has done for me. But sometimes it can happen in all relationships that sometimes the other person may make too many demands, or the relationship may be very fractious, and then we may not feel inspired to serve at that time. So that time, if you remember, yeah, I am serving Krishna through this person. But then at least we will be inspired to keep doing the right thing. So we can't, if we see our relationship as only one and two, then our relationship will become very dependent on what the other person is doing. Our relationship cannot be independent of what they are doing, because there is reciprocation. But our relationship should not be only dependent on what they are doing. There is a higher principle of serving Krishna. So rather than, if we feel inspired, yes, this is my mother and she has done so much for me, so I am serving her, or I am serving Krishna through her, whichever way it works out, the important thing is do the right thing. And gradually, as we keep practicing bhakti, rather than seeing this as separate, now when we say is Manav Seva Madhav Seva, actually there is a complex understanding over here. Now Krishna thrice talks about Sarva Bhuta Hite Rataha in the Bhagavad Gita. And he talks about even impersonal is being Sarva Bhuta Hite Rataha. About how in 5.25 he talks about Labante Brahma Nirvana Rishayakshina Kalmasa Chinna Dvaidha Aydatmana Sarva Bhuta Hite Rataha. Like that he talks about many times. So the point is that when we see the absolute truth, we see the connectedness of the absolute truth with everything and with everyone, and we serve them also. So the problem is not that is manav seva madhav seva. The problem is that when madhav seva is seen as the only way, necessary way to do madhav seva, that the one extreme can be I do only manav seva and don't do any madhav seva at all. That means I just feed the poor and I think that's all I need to do. The other extreme is that I do only madhav seva and I don't care for manav at all. Then we become like bhajanandis. Then we don't really, we are not really sharing Krishna consciousness with others. So we do manav seva through, as a part of our madhav seva itself, we do manav seva. That is, we care for people and help them come closer to Krishna. So by the way we conduct ourselves, our relatives come closer to Krishna, then that is both manav seva and madhav seva combined together. So the primary problem with manav seva is madhav seva logic is that manav seva is thought of as a substitute of madhav seva, and not just a substitute, they say it is a superior substitute, because you can see God only in the temple, but we can see God in the poor people also, therefore we are higher than you. That is a serious misunderstanding. So manav seva is not a substitute for madhav seva, but when we are rooted in the culture of madhav seva, then we can serve madhav by connecting the manav with the madhav, and that is the essence of preaching. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Yes, Prabhu. Hare Krishna. Yes,
Prabhu. Hare Krishna. Thank you, Prabhu. Most relationships, they go through these different stages of attachment, detachment, and then hopefully commitment. We can see people becoming attached to a spiritual leader or in some way or the other, and then eventually they become detached again because of the time factor. Where does the level of commitment come in? Like nowadays we see we have a lot of sympathizers from different groups and sections, and they're in some way attached. But then again, detachment comes, because to arise actual commitment is not such an easy thing. Like you see, it's not a criteria how many people are watching something on the web or social media, but where does the level of commitment actually come in? And how can we, as practitioners, increase that level of commitment in ourselves and in others? Because it's a very non-committal time that we're living in right now, and thus trust is very weak. Yeah. And also taste is very less, because commitment is a lacking factor. Thank you.
So in our relationship with devotees also, sometimes we go through attachment and detachment, and then where does the commitment come in, and how can we develop that commitment? See, our relationship with devotees, especially those devotees who say inspires in our bhakti,
especially for new people who are coming,
those who inspire us in bhakti, that evolves more or less in a similar way like a child's relationship evolves with the parents. The child is newborn, the child is completely dependent on the parents. So for the children, the parents are practically like God. They can do no wrong. Whatever they do is perfect. And that's our initial attitude towards the devotees who have brought us to bhakti. We're very reverential, very respectful. We think, oh, you are a pure devotee. You are the representative of Krishna for me. You know, whatever you say, it is Sakshat Paramatma speaking through you. We think like that. And then, you know, when children get into teenage and adolescence, then they go to the other extreme. You know, rather than, earlier they said, my parents can do no wrong, then the adolescence, if my parents tell it, it must be wrong. So, they go into rebellious phase. And to some extent, this is natural, because as they grow up, as their intelligence develops to some extent, they also develop their own individuality, and they start seeing, you know, parents also have flaws. But over a period of time, they should outgrow that adolescence. And they understand, yes, my parents are not perfect, but nor are they ill-motivated, nor are they bad. No, they have done a lot for me. And then there is a relationship that is based on reality, where there is gratitude, where there is acknowledgement of what they have done, and there is also recognition that they are not perfect. So similarly, in our relationship with devotees, we initially think that, you know, maybe, as I said, that the devotees are perfect. And then afterwards, we start seeing faults with them. Then we start feeling, you know, oh, nobody cares for me. Everybody has their own agendas. Then nobody is actually, there's no selfless attitude here. And everybody is busy in their projects. And then we start becoming very judgmental. And we start becoming very negative of devotees. But as we move onwards, we start recognizing that, yes, everybody is imperfect. Even the devotees who are guiding us, they also may have their limitations. But most devotees are not ill-intentioned. They are not ill-intentioned. They desire to serve Krishna and they are serving Krishna to the best of their capacity. And quite often, if we're honest, the best of their capacity is much, much more than what is the best of our capacity. So we recognize what they are doing and we are grateful for them. Another point in this is that Rupa Goswami says in Bhakti Saranam Sindhu that we need Sajatiya Ashaya Bhagwat Bhakti Sangha. He says we need like-minded devotee association. And as we grow in bhakti, then gradually we start understanding our own mind. That means we come to Sattvaguna and we start understanding our own nature. Prabhupada writes in the introduction of Nectar of Instruction that as we come to the mode of goodness, then everything about how to advance will be revealed from within. That essentially means we start understanding our own nature, not nature necessarily in terms of Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, but basically what is our raga, what is our likes, what are our dislikes, what is it that inspires us, what is it that causes us hesitation. And then as we start understanding our own nature, we will naturally look for that devotee association which is like-minded. So it may not necessarily be true that the devotees who inspired us initially in bhakti, they may have the same like-mindedness that we have. So now one way of looking at it is that, you know, we should just surrender to our senior devotees and we just do what they're telling us to do. If we can do that, that is fine. But if we can't do that, if our natures are very different, then we take the blessings, take the sanction of our senior devotee, and we get a primary devotional nourishment from those devotees who are like-minded. Prabhupada has given us a house in which the whole world can live. So that means there are devotees of many different dispositions, and as long as we are broadly engaged in the service of Krishna, we find a like-minded devotee association and we continue on in practicing bhakti. So rather than, again, as I said, we don't see that relationship with the devotee as only the relationship with that devotee. That means that it is the same Krishna who inspired me earlier through one Vaishnava is now inspiring me through another Vaishnava. So rather than seeing that, so neither of those devotees, you know, the devotees who were guiding us earlier, they also should be mature. They should not think that, oh, this person has become an upstart, has rejected me now, is gone, become a deviant and gone somewhere else. No, they should know that it's Krishna who acted through me, inspired me, and now that same Krishna may inspire them through someone else. So if we see the Krishna connection, because we know that those devotees inspired me, those devotees did a lot for me, we have gratitude for those devotees. But at the same time, all of us, we have to find the best way in which we can serve Krishna lifelong. And that is, if throughout our life we need someone else to keep pushing us, then we will not be able to make very tangible advancement in bhakti, because we'll be too dependent on others' pushes. Yes, we always need devotee association, we always need to be pushed to some extent. Prabhupada gives an example about this pushing. He says that, suppose, you know, sometimes in India, a car doesn't start. So then people come around and they start pushing the car. They all push the car and the car starts. Now inside, the person is trying to get the car to turn on and move, and outside people are pushing. And then the car moves. But suppose the person inside the car goes to sleep. And then the outside people will say, why should I push? Or worse still, the outside people are pushing and the person is pressing the brake inside. So, so like that. So devotees push us, but we also have to push ourselves. You know, if we actively counter push, then how long a devotee is going to keep pushing us? So in some relationships, if we don't feel inspired in that particular relationship within bhakti, if we are always dependent on others pushing us, we have to some extent get some inspiration in our own life so that we can serve Krishna. And within that inspiration, we get we get inspiration from other devotees who are doing that similar service. So the important thing is that we don't disrespect or reject those devotees who have helped us earlier. But it is also natural that as we grow in our spiritual life, the same devotees who inspired it in a particular way, they may not inspire us later. That's just the way. They grow, we grow. But we are grateful for what they have done for us. And it shouldn't be that we reject them. We still respect them. We're still grateful to them. But we need to see how is Krishna inspiring me? And how can I keep serving Krishna? So the element of commitment is primarily in our service to Krishna. And those who are assisting us in our service to Krishna, especially our spiritual master, we take the blessings of the spiritual master. Or at least we are working under the guidance of the spiritual master in a broad sense. But there is also the element of taking one's own initiative in bhakti. We have to follow the instructions, but while following instructions, we also have to understand how I can best serve. And in that way, within the movement itself, we can find a service which we can do sustainably. So, I don't know, did I answer your question? Can speak
Hare up. Krishna. Yes, thank you. Especially like the point about initiative. It's a very crucial issue because to be a loyal and obedient follower of Parampara and work in an institution like ISKCON and at the same time taking initiative may sometimes seem like an apparent contradiction where people tend to become either spiritual entrepreneurs or they become very ambitious for their own project that you mentioned earlier, or they just wait for the institution to tell them what to do. And maybe the solution is somewhere in the middle, balance between the two paradigms. So where does that level of maturity come into play?
Yeah. So how do we balance between, say, waiting for instructions and taking initiative? See, it's primarily a matter of introspection and consultation. But we, at least in the initial years of our life, we do what we are told to do. And while doing that, we observe ourselves. Hey, I'm good at doing this. I am quite comfortable. I'm quite confident. So basically, guna karma vibhagasha, when we say, chaturvarna maya susha guna karma vibhagasha, that guna and karma determine our. So now guna and karma, we could say, is basically guna is our internal comfort in doing something, karma is external competence in doing that thing. So we feel comfortable in doing it and we are good at doing it. If those two things are there, then we understand this is what I'm good at. So that introspection we need to do. And then if we feel inspired to serve in a particular, we consult with senior devotees. And by that consultation, we understand it is what I should be doing. Thank you very much. Grantraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Jai Itai Gaur Premanande.